Hey folks, it's Ray, DCRainmaker.com here, and today I've got seven new things to know about the Fitbit Sense. Now, this is a full review of the Fitbit Sense, but I'm going to start off with kind of the basics first for like a minute or two, and then I'll dive into all those seven new features and then the accuracy. And you definitely want to stay around for the accuracy, because after all, if you're buying this watch, you want it to be accurate. And we got to chat about some of that stuff. Now, you can use the YouTube chapters along the bottom there to simply scroll along to the section you want. So if you're old hat at Fitbit, you can skip this next minute or so and go right into all the new features. First, I should mention the price. It's $329, which is by far the most expensive Fitbit to date. That includes the default watch band that I'm wearing right now. But as with the past, you can buy other accessory watch bands as well and change it up if you want to. Now, of course, the Fitbit Sense is essentially like the next version of the Ioniq or the Versa watches. So it's got all the same normal features you'd expect from a Fitbit. So you've got, of course, tracking your steps and your sleep and your sleep stages. It has built-in GPS, so when you go out for a run or a ride, you don't need to take your phone with you. It's got that all built in, and it'll, of course, upload after the fact, not only to Fitbit, but to Strava and other platforms as well. Assuming your bank is supported, you can load your credit card onto the Fitbit Sense using Fitbit Pay, which allows you to then use contactless payments at a store or whatnot to pay for things. Very similar, again, in the past to the Ioniq and the Versa series. You'll want to double check your bank, though, because they vary quite a bit country to country. And then, like those watches in the past, there's also the Fitbit App Store. You can download watch faces there as well as regular apps. Most of the apps there, like most wearable apps, are pretty basic. They're kind of like cut down versions of phone apps. Now, there's two options for display on the Sense. The first is the default, which is raised to wake, which means the display is off when you have it down like this, and then when you bring it up, it turns it on. Or you can have always on display, which is what you see right now, where it's down like this, and it'll go into the watch face in just a second, or basically like a low power watch face. And then once I raise it up, it goes away from the time and shows me the full watch face itself. In the case of always on, Fitbit claims about 2 days. In the case of raised awake, claims about 5 days. Seems pretty consistent with what I'm seeing as well. Now, while it is a touchscreen display, there is a single button that's on the underside right there. And I gotta be honest, it's a super awkward place to put a button because normally you take your wrist across like this and you press the button like that. But here you have to like go underneath. It's really, really weird. And it makes a little vibration once you do touch it, but it's just not an awesome button placement. Next, like other recent Fitbits, you can load music onto the watch, and you can take that music and then play it back through headphones, Bluetooth headphones. You can put both Pandora and Deezer on the watch itself, offline music, and go out again without your phone anywhere, as well as MP3s. There's also Spotify control, but you can't put Spotify songs on the watch. You have to only be controlling your phone. So just keep that in mind. It's one kind of downside right there. And last but not least, well, not part of the new things coming to the Sense, there is the SpO2 measurement. This is something that Fitbit actually rolled out in some of their other watches. And I wanted to mention here in particular because, you know, with Apple Watch Series 6 introducing it, it's something that's got a lot of attention recently. And the way it works on the Fitbit Sense is you have to load this watch face. So you can see that watch face right there. Without that watch face loaded, though, it won't work. And it's really a bizarre situation because every other watch out there, like the Apple Watch, Garmin watches, etc., you can turn SpO2 on or off if you want to primarily save battery life, or you can do manual readings when you want to. But in the case of Fitbit, it only does those readings at night and only if you have this watch face installed. And unfortunately, this watch face isn't awesome. It's not graphically awesome, and more importantly, I find it super laggy. It takes a long time to get into it, doesn't respond very fast. So that is one bummer. I wish it would just simply do that under the covers, quite literally, behind the scenes all the time. Still, hopefully that's something they can change down the road with a software update or something like that. So with that, we're gonna dive into the seven new things. And for that, I wanna bring a box up here. That way I can show you this stuff kind of nice and easily from the overhead cam as I go through each one of these features. And the first one is a new EDA scan. This is the electrodermal activity scan. And essentially, this is basically another word for a galvanic skin response sensor. And so the way you activate it is that you go on to the watch itself, you swipe to the right, you swipe to the right, there we go, now it responds, swipe to the right, and then hit EDA scan, and then you can walk through either a 2-minute test or a longer test, or scan as they call it. So I'll tap that like this, take this hand here, my right hand, I'm gonna put it over the top. You can obviously use the other hand if you're on the other wrist, take it like this, and now it vibrates for a second, and I'll wait for 2 minutes. So I'll do that first, nice and quiet. Oh, hey, and if you are finding this video interesting or useful or anything at all, if you whack that like button, it really helps out the video and the channel quite a bit. Okay, so it just buzzed in a little bit. Now I'm done. You'll see the all done message right there. Now, again, this is measuring essentially like your sweat, a little bit of your palm. And from that, they can determine a bit more. Now it's going to ask to reflect on how I feel. So I'll click log that. And I'm going to say I'm neutral right now. There we go. And it gives me a bit of a kind of how many times I've done it this week so far, EDA responses. Now, it doesn't give you any context for what this means. There's a start and a 2-minute marker, but that's it. You can't like look into this data anywhere that I can find on the watch or on the app and see like what it actually means under the covers. And if you go on down here, you can see my heart rate decrease from 66 to 61. Obviously, you do this normally on a couch or somewhere else, a little less awkward than sitting here with cameras pointing at you. It'd be a little bit lower heart rate. And then once you take this data, the idea is that you go into their stress management app there. And so let me show you that right now. Okay, so here is the Fitbit app opened up, and there's my stress management button right there at the top. I tap that, and it's got my one from earlier today, but you don't actually see that yet. So the one at 11:13, I put it stressed, and I can't really tap on that. I can tap on it there, but it doesn't show me any scores yet. So you don't get the scores right away, so it's just sort of like a, that's it, I just choose my feeling. If I go back, I can choose a different day though. So let me go down to, let's see, Sunday, I did two different ones right there. And you can see I did one very calm at 11:10 p.m., one calm at 4:44 p.m., and then I've got these scores up the top there. But I also can't tap on any of those scores either. So the scores, responsiveness, exertion balance, and sleep patterns. And the idea between each one of those is they measure different things and are combined scores. So down responsiveness, for example, you can see is heart rate variability, resting heart rate, the EDA, that's a bit of that sweat thing we just did right there with the palm on top of it. And then you go down to exertion, that gets in steps and we get activity and fitness fatigue scores and then sleep patterns. And all these things sound good. And this is sort of, if you want to get like the preview for this video, I guess halfway into it now, is that there is a ton of data that Fitbit's gathering and they give you these scores, but they don't tell you how to do anything with it. So this is just the explainer. This is just a help screen right here. It's not my actual data. So once I look at my actual data, if we go again back to another day like Saturday, it shows me the score, but I can't tap on any part of it. I can't see why responsiveness is at 27 out of 30. I can't see why exertion is at 40 out of 40 or why sleep patterns is only 19 out of 30. So let's move into the next one here, which is ECG. Now, ECG is something we saw Apple introduce on the Apple Watch in Series 4, and then also in Series 5 and Series 6 now as well. We saw Withings introduce it, and there's been a couple others out there as well, but it's not enabled quite yet. That's coming sometime in October. They just received regulatory approval last week for that. And that'll be in the US, a number of countries in Europe, as well as Hong Kong and India at launch. And of course, that'll probably expand beyond that based on regulatory approval outside of that. I can't show that to you today because it's literally not on the watch quite yet. Next is breathing rate. That's another feature that you can't really see on the watch, but it's something that you'll do later on in the app itself. So if we go to today on the app, you go down into health trends, and then from there you wait a couple seconds and you see breathing rate. Breathing rate is measured at night on the Fitbit Sense, as long as you have sleep for more than 3 hours. I can tap on this right here and see my breathing rate trends over time. You can see right now it's roughly fluctuating about 13 breaths per minute, which is pretty normal for me. Between 12 and 14 is sort of my norm over long periods of time. I've been measuring that as well on both a Garmin watch as well as a Whoop band for the last year, I guess I could say, and it's pretty much the norm there. Next, there is the heart rate variability tracking. You can scroll down in the same area and see the HRV tracking. The same overall pattern right there as we saw for breathing rate, heart rate variability listed there, and you can trend that over longer periods of time as well. Now, both of these metrics fall under the health metrics dashboard, and this is something that up until just this morning, Fitbit was going to require a premium membership to. But starting at some point in the quote coming months, this will be available for all users free, this particular portion. And that gets to part of one of the bigger catches with the Sense. There is a lot of features in the Fitbit Sense that are premium only. You see the top of my page has Fitbit Premium. I paid for that, but I don't know what are free and what are premium. And I've asked Fitbit that. I've asked them for like a really clear cut, kind of like a table of what's free and what's premium. Haven't really got that. I got some text that kind of shows some features, but as I dig around, I get the feeling there's other features that don't really fit into those buckets. And so I really like to see them be super crystal clear on what's free and what's premium. Otherwise, it's kind of tough to know. In general, though, the basic kind of idea is that most features are free to see the Now data. But if you want to see the trending and recommendations data, then that requires a Fitbit premium subscription. The next new feature is the skin temperature tracking. So back here on the today page, we see this one right there, a little temperature icon next to it. And that's showing my skin temperature over the last few nights. Now it needs 3 nights of baseline data to start with. And that can include up to 30 nights of baseline data. And then it shows you the difference from the baseline each night that you sleep. So if you look at Sunday, which is actually Saturday night, but I woke up on Sunday, you can see there, I am pretty close to my baseline, which makes sense. And then if we look at Monday night, you can see it dips down towards the end of the night, gets a bit cooler, if you will. Remember, this is just measuring the temperature of the skin, not your core temperature. That is different. What is interesting about this, though, is that the last two nights had the window open in the room, and it's pretty cool here in the Netherlands at night now in the fall. And so you can see that drop in temperature. Is that this year? Probably, but can I prove that? Not necessarily. I can tell you, though, that Saturday night, the Sunday one that stood there, the window was closed and it kept pretty even temperature over the course of the night. Next on the list is the newly added microphone to this. Now, this is going to kind of take a couple different phases over the course of the life of the Sense. The first one is today, I can ask Alexa different things, and then later on down this year, I can ask Google Assistant different things, and then sometime this winter, I'll be able to take calls on the watch itself as long as my cell phone is in range. But with the exception of Alexa, none of those things are here today. So let me show you that right now. So I go swipe to the right, I find the phone out of the way there, swipe to the right, I find Alexa in here. There we go. Hey Alexa, what's the weather in New York City today? It thinks. There we go. So looks like it'll be a nice day in New York City today. And you know, pretty basic stuff. It's not gonna talk back to me though, it's just gonna do that. I can also configure this button on the left-hand side there to be an Alexa command if I wanted. I can choose a quick press. I can choose like Fitbit today, I'm sorry, Fitbit Pay or today or Alexa, whatever the case is, and get to that same menu a little more quickly than going through all the apps right there. Now you may be asking yourself, do I trust Fitbit now that it's going to be owned by Google, not owned yet, hasn't been approved, with accessing or having a microphone on my wrist? And you can decide for yourself, but you can turn that off. So if I go into the settings here, vibrations and audio, and the microphone, I can turn that on or off entirely. And that'll then theoretically not have the microphone on when I'm just doing other things. Finally, the last new item before we talk about accuracy, and this ties into accuracy, is the new PurePulse optical heart rate sensor. That's what they brand their optical heart rate sensor. And this one is the PurePulse 2.0. I'm gonna clean it off because it looks a little sketchy on my skin like that. There we go, nice and shiny. Bring it down there, and you can see that optical heart rate sensor, the green lights just turned off right there, but that's going ahead and measuring my heart rate with the green lights. And then when you see the red lights, which you wouldn't be able to see unless it's nighttime, then that would be the SpO2 sensor doing its thing. That's the new optical heart rate sensor, and Fitbit made kind of a big deal of it. So we should probably then go look at the actual accuracy data from my runs and workouts. I've been doing workouts now for about a week with it, and I've got a pretty good idea compared to lots of different devices on how it handles. But let's just go to the computer and look at some of this data. So here's the first example in brown of it being massively wrong at the beginning, as well as throughout the run. And you can see just it's huge. It's like 15, 18 beats over. In this case here in orange across the vast majority of the run, as well as the intervals being down low, here in green, spiking up above it, and again, spiking up well above everyone else in the interval section. And then here as well in brown, down below everyone else, it's just wrong almost every single time on every single workout, and substantially wrong against every single sensor I've thrown at, and really half a dozen different sensors, it's always wrong. Now, there is a bright side here, which is that the GPS data is actually just perfectly fine. I mean, except tunnels and bridges. Those it does not like very much, but for the most part, everywhere else I went, it wasn't too bad. The track, all that kind of stuff was basically in the ballpark of most other watches in this price point. Okay, so with the accuracy pieces out of the way, what's the overall like conclusion on this thing? And we can get the box out of the way, I guess. It's tough. Like, I see the potential of where Fitbit wants to go with this. I see that, you know, they have all this sensor information, and there are all these kind of cool metrics they could do with stuff, all this potential trending information. But today, I'm actually more confused than when I started with it. When I started wearing it, I'm like, oh, this is interesting stuff. It's cool. It's starting to track things. But as each day went on, I didn't understand the relationships between all the different things. There's no clear-cut guidance in really any of the modules on the app or on the watch as to what I should do with any of that data whatsoever. And that's sort of the point of a watch like this. So I like the idea here, but I think the execution just needs a bit more refinement. Anyways, hopefully you found this interesting or useful or something like that. If so, simply whack that like button at the bottom there, or hit the subscribe button for plenty more sports technology goodness. With that, have a good one.